church of Smyrna. The church of Smyrna is in Revelation chapter 2, verse 8, as we move through Revelation. Write this letter to the angel of the church in Smyrna. This is the message. Here's another message from the one who is the first and the last, who was dead. Notice through these letters, Jesus is introducing himself in a different way. Who was dead, but is now alive. Verse 9, I know about your suffering and your poverty, but you are rich. This is what the Lord is saying to the church. I know the blasphemy of those opposing you. They say they're Jews, but they're not, because their synagogue belongs to Satan. And this is for all of you that are like, are Pharisees still Christians? This is what Jesus says. Their synagogue belongs to Satan. Don't be afraid for what you're about to suffer. The devil, listen to what he says here. The devil will throw some of you into prison to test you. You will suffer for 10 days, but if you remain faithful, even when facing death, I will give you the crown of life. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to what the Spirit and understand what he's saying to the churches. Whoever is victorious will not be harmed by the second death. So here's the second church in Smyrna. Number one, there's no rebuke for this church. He says, here's what I want you guys to understand. You are under and you're coming under incredible persecution and suffering. Now, this for many of you listening in America, this is not matter to you because you're like, I've never been persecuted. I want to give you this bold warning. What the Lord has showed me, we are getting ready and we will come under intense persecution in the days ahead. I'm talking about martyred, getting persecuted, hate crime. People are going to hate us. They're going to kill us. They're going to martyr us. So don't think that this is not happening right now, because it's happening all over the world. In this letter, as I read this in Revelation 2:8, reminds me and makes me think of the church in Afghanistan. And here's what I want you to understand. Hebrews 13:3 says, remember those in prison as if you were there yourself. Remember those being mistreated as if you felt the pain in your own body. Now, if you are in prison right now for being a Christian, like many are all over the world, are you going to forget that you're in prison? Are you going to be in prison and be like, oh man, it's Sunday, I totally forgot I was in prison? No, you're going to always know I'm in prison. And the writer of Hebrews says, remember them as if you were in prison. Remember them as if you yourself were in prison. So this should be every day. We should somehow remember those that are in prison. And he says, remember those being mistreated as if you felt the pain in your own body. So again, today I won't go into detail because it's graphic. I was reading about what the Taliban is doing right now as I preach, what the Taliban is doing to believers, that they're skinning them alive, they're putting them on crosses, they're taking their children. And I can't go into detail because it'll get flagged and taken down, but it's unspeakable what they're doing. And this is what the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 13, as if they're doing it to you, as if you felt the pain in your own body, as if when you read about it and you hear about these atrocious crimes, you're like, it hurts me. I feel it in my own body because these are my brothers and sisters. And guys, I want you to think about this. I wrote our Demon Slayer group, our group text. I said, guys, my heart is broken because I am right now, and I get emotional talking about it, and I'm trying not to get emotional here, but I'm right now in my office streaming all over the world to 4,000 people, almost 3,900 people live. My wife and kids are out there, you know, eating whatever they want to eat on our nice couch, listening to me stream on our big screen, and zero persecution. No one's knocking on our door. I have people knocking on my door, you know, trying to sell me solar panels. And here they are hiding underground, running from society, running from the governor. They can't call the police because the police are the ones that are after them, being persecuted by the Taliban for their faith. And the next knock on the door, the Taliban comes in, takes their children, and does unspeakable things to them and their children. Like, literally right now this is happening while me and you are getting DoorDash and getting Wingstop. I mean, this is, now thinking about this, it's so far from reality because I can't even imagine somebody knocking on my door and saying, if you don't renounce your faith, I'm taking your four daughters. This is their life. This is how they live. Now, again, I don't know how I can use my platform to help them. I'm gonna connect with one of the guys this week that's working with the churches in Afghanistan. But guys, this is what we have to remember. These I can't just sit by, live stream, be in my comfortable house and not do something and not help somehow, because these are our brothers and sisters. And you have to realize the non-persecuted church is the minority. Most of the world is being persecuted for their faith. And in this letter, the Lord does not say, I'm gonna deliver you, Church of Smyrna. He says, I'm going to reward you. In other words, I'm going to allow you to be persecuted, But don't worry, because if you remain faithful, I'm going to give you the crown of life. Now, again, these passages mean nothing to you because you don't get persecuted. You don't even share your faith at work when you're allowed to. God forbid we do it when we're allowed to, yet they're doing it when they're not allowed to. He says, I know you're in poverty. This was a church in poverty. He says, but I say you're rich. So you have to understand that we might be rich in America in the world's eyes, but does Jesus call us rich? Some of the richest Christians live in third world countries, and some of the poorest Christians live in America. Because you could have $1 million in your bank and be poor according to Jesus. I don't want to be poor in the eyes of Jesus and rich in the eyes of man. I would rather be poor in the eyes of man and rich in the eyes of Jesus, because Jesus said these believers were persecuted, but I believe the church in Afghanistan is 1,000 times richer than the church in America in our fancy buildings and our $150,000, $300,000 a year salaries and our, you know, huge buildings, huge air conditioned units, huge light systems, the millions of dollars we spend on lights and on sound and on equipment. I believe the church in Afghanistan is infinitely richer than the church of America, according to this passage. So many of us have wealth, but we're spiritually bankrupt. Now, during suffering, because we will suffer, and please, if you're like, why does this matter to me? There's many believers in the chat that are in other parts of the world that are being persecuted. During suffering, we have a choice to be bitter or to be better. Pain is like a chisel that will either shape you or destroy you, and you have to choose to let the suffering either shape you and mold you or to destroy you. So please know that inevitably a day of persecution is coming to America. Matthew chapter 5 verse 10 says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven belongs to the persecuted church. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 12. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. So Timothy, understand, everybody, Paul says, that wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. Maybe we're not being persecuted because we're not living a godly life. We're living an American westernized life, a westernized Jesus. 2 Corinthians 12:10 says, that is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardships, and persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So the weaker I get, the stronger Christ gets. Luke 6:22. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, when they insult you, when they reject you because of the Son of Man. Over and over, Jesus talks about persecution. This is a real reality. And just because you don't face it doesn't mean it's not happening all over the world. Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those that persecute you. This is our call. The church in Afghanistan, they pray for the Taliban. This is what they're called to do. So we need to pray for those. So stop being one of these believers that are like, someone made fun of me. Think about this. This week, people were saying, what do you think about people on YouTube that are, you know, talking bad about you or making fun of you or slandering you or saying you're false? And you know what I could think about? Is that really even a question when my brothers and sisters in Afghanistan are running right now as I speak from the control of the Taliban being martyred? You think I care? You think I really care about what some basement dweller makes a video about me on YouTube that's doing nothing for God when there's people out there for their faith? That's not persecution. Friend, listen to me closely. People making YouTube videos about me is not persecution. Having someone knock at my door and take my children and then murder them in front of me, that's persecution. So I don't even waste my time licking my wounds and crying about, oh, somebody made a Facebook post about me, a YouTube video about me. No, I'm gonna spend that time praying for my persecuted brothers and sisters in Afghanistan. This is what we need to do. So you need to understand this. The city, Smyrna, was incredibly wealthy. The church was poor, but God says, I have a crown for you. Even though you're in the midst of a city full of shrines, false gods, they had gods there of Aphrodite, Apollo, Zeus, all these gods are there. This church is poor. They're remaining faithful. They're being persecuted. And God said, this is the church I have nothing bad to say about, but I have a crown of life for this church. And this is, understand, in the midst of persecution, they're remaining strong. Now, Jesus' solution to persecution was remain faithful, because they're going to kill you. They're going to throw you in prison, but I want you to remain faithful. Now, I read an article today about a pastor in a persecuted nation. And he said this. He's a pastor in a persecuted church. He said, it's the strangest thing where the war has been the bloodiest, where the needs are the most desperate. This is where the church has grown the most. Yes, brethren, become martyrs. Yet remember, this is what he said, and I get all emotional talking about this. The heavier the cross, the more powerful the resurrection. This is a pastor in the persecuted nation. Lord, I pray tonight, Lord, help us to get our eyes off the natural and understand that this is a reality for so many people. Imagine so many Christians in this city that are preaching against idol, the persecution that they went through. And Jesus opens the opening statement to this church in verse 8, as this is the message from the one who was, who is the first and the last, who is dead and is now alive. In other words, here's why Jesus opened up the story like this. He said this, I've been there. I've been there. Church, I could relate. He's telling this persecuted church, I was dead. They killed me and I'm alive again. He says, I know what you're going through. I know what it's like to be persecuted. I know what it's like to be in poverty. I know what it's like to be slandered. I know what it's like to suffer death. I'm the first. I'm the last. I was there in the beginning. I was there in the middle. I'm there at the end. I know what you're going through. I know your works, your tribulation, your poverty. And yet he calls them rich. The church in Afghanistan, the Lord calls them rich, calls them blessed because of the persecution they've gone through. And you know, I get frustrated because in America, we're so lavish and we're so extravagant. We have so much, yet we have so little in the eyes of God. But here's what Jesus said. I'm going to offer you the crown of life, the promise that these believers will not be hurt by the second death. That is spiritual death, but they're only going to die once. And then they're going to have the promise of eternal life.